Hi friends, at DAMS we have initiated a series called as Medicine Unplugged on DAMS YouTube channel, where we discuss various clinical scenarios and we try to image and look at the imaging findings with respect to the clinical findings of the disease. Today I have with me Dr. Gaurav Patel. He is a renowned surgery faculty and will be looking at the clinical aspect of an important disease. And that problem is something which you will encounter as an undergraduate appearing for any exam. And I believe that the topic that we are going to discuss today is even important for the residents. Be you are a radiology resident or a surgery resident, it's a very important topic to look at. And the topic that we are going to look at is renal trauma. And you know, you can look at the image at the background of our discussion today, and you can already see that CECT, a contrast NR CT, is the mainstay of imaging in a patient with renal trauma. You know, even before we start looking at patients with various patterns of injury and grades of injury, I'll ask Gaurav to enlighten us on that. Why would a surgeon advise a CT in a patient with suspected renal trauma? Or, you know, going backward, you know, when would you actually suspect renal trauma?
Renal trauma is a very commonly encountered condition in the surgical emergencies, and most of the traumas are due to blunt injury, that is mainly acceleration or deceleration injury. Also in the penetrating abdominal injury, it is seen. If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, then in those scenarios we will take up the patient straight away to the OT. If fast is available, we will get a fast done. Otherwise, most of the time patient will be taken up directly for the surgery. But if the patient is stable enough to get a CT done, then we'll advise ECT, that is the investigation of choice. Also in the patients of suspected renal trauma with gross hematuria, CT is advisable. And the patient is having microhematuria with a fall in BP that is less than 90, at any time during the evaluation or during the resuscitation, CT is indicated. So these are the scenarios where you will get a CT in the patients of suspected renal trauma.
I think Gaurav has made a very valid point. There is that valid point is that if a patient is hemodynamically unstable with a suspected renal injury, you know, it's a very important question as well. So when they say investigation of choice and they don't mention stable, unstable, we assume the patient to be stable and we go for CECT as the IOC. However, if they mention the patient is hemodynamically unstable, you have to take those patients directly to the OT. And if required in the OT, and I'm sure Gaurav will elaborate, you might go for a single shot IVP in this patient.
Yeah, because if the patient, if we take up the patient to the OT without knowing the staging of the renal trauma, and you encountered a retroperitoneal hematoma during the intraoperatively, then in those cases, before you open the gerotas fascia and go for the kidney, you need to know the function of the other kidney also, because there are some certain cases, especially when the patient is hemodynamically unstable, to save the life of the patient, you might have to do a nephrectomy. So in that case, knowing the status of the contralateral kidney is very important. That is the indication where there is the role of one shot IVP is there. In that case, you will give 2 ml per kg of the contrast material and you will take a delayed film, mainly after 10 minutes, basically to seal the status of the contralateral kidney. And for that side, the ipsilateral kidney also, you will get some kind of information regarding if you see the contrast, whether there is contrast exacerbation and these things. So that is the only indication when you go for a single shot IVP, that if you encounter a retroperitoneal hematoma during the surgery.
I feel that, you know, it's a very important thing for the undergraduates and the residents also listening to us today, that the prime reason we are doing IVU here is to look at the function of the
contralateral kidney.
And the information that we get about the damaged kidney is a bonus.
Yeah.
But the main thing that we are looking for is the opposite.
For the opposite. Because many times the patient is having maybe only single functioning kidney.
And you do an nephrectomy.
Yeah. So in that case, you give, like nowadays, like few people, they say that there is no point doing this because anyways, you will always try to preserve the kidney. But still, you will have, if you get a one shot IVP, you will always have something in the back of the mind that you have to preserve as far as possible in this case.
Yeah. So let us look at the first image and, you know, try to correlate it clinically. So this is the contrast NR CT scan that you see here. You can see this is the right kidney and this is the dye being excreted into the renal pelvis here.
Yes.
And you can see this is the aorta. Some atherosclerotic changes are there in the aorta, but you can see this is the IVC. These are the black things that you see above are your bowel loops. And you can see easily it is spotable that the problem is in the left kidney. And now you have a patient with road traffic accident, hematuria, and a CT scan looking like this. So what are you able to see? So you can see there is something, you know, in relation to the kidney, which is distorting the contour of the kidney. This is what is called a subcapsular hematoma. So there is a patient with a subcapsular hematoma in the kidney, and you can see some stranding in the surrounding fat, all related to trauma. and there is no cortical lesion here, there is no cortical laceration here. We can see a subcapsular hematoma distorting and flattening the contour of the kidney.
Yes.
So such injuries, according to the American Association of Surgical Trauma Staging, you would say stage 1.
It is stage 1 injury. According to AAST, it is stage 1 injury, that is non-expanding subcapsular hematoma confined to the kidney. So that will be subcapsular hematoma. It is not going into the perinephric space. It is not extending into the cortex or into the medulla. So this is just a subcapsular hematoma. And most of the times these patients, because you can see the hematoma is not large, so most of the time these patients are hemodynamically stable. So you'll get a CCT and you will see this, and you can continue the conservative management. Most of the times you don't need to take up the patient for surgery in these cases. They can be easily managed conservatively.
Let us look at one more patient with a renal trauma. Now you can see yourself where is the problem. You can see the problem is on the right side. You can see the right kidney is, can you see the first look, it's pushed up, it's pushed anteriorly. Maybe there is some perinephric hematoma pushing the kidney anteriorly. This is what we are able to see here. But another important thing that you can see here is, look at the cortex. There is some discontinuity here. So there is a cortical laceration. So whenever we see a cortical laceration, you have to see how big it is. Definitely this is less than 1 centimeter in size, and it is not extending up to the pelvic lysis system or excretory system here, or the urinary
pelvic lysis system.
So now we have a patient with a perinephric hematoma with a cortical laceration less than 1 centimeter in size. These are grade 2 injuries.
Yes, sir. This is grade 2 injury. And again, in these cases also, most of the patients can be managed conservatively. So that is conservative management is for these patients also. The only thing is, if in cases, if the hematoma is large and you think that it might be compressing, then you can do a percutaneous drainage, but that is not required. These patients are very well managed conservatively only. So grade 1, grade 2, these are considered as a low grade injuries, which can be easily managed conservatively.
Let's look at one more patient here. Now we have more anatomy visible on this kidney. So I try to, show you more anatomy here. You can see this is your liver. That is your portal vein, right branch going into the liver, right kidney. You can see in front, you can see a little bit of the adrenal, inferior vena cava, aorta, left kidney, and you can also see this spleen here. So you can again see there is some perinephric hematoma, and you might be thinking in your mind, sir, why, how do we say is it a hematoma or a urinoma? We look at the Hounsfield value usually, and if the Hounsfield value is 30 and above, we are usually looking at a hematoma. Between 0 to 20, you are looking at a urinoma. Another factor which would help us to look at a urinoma would be the contrast excavation that would happen in a delayed stage.
Yes.
Now, in this patient, you can see there is a left kidney showing a cortical laceration. And what is the peculiarity that you see here? There is a perinephric hematoma, but the laceration is more than 1 centimeter in size. But still, it is not extending to the pelvic lysis system. So, we will call it grade 3.
Grade 3.
I also want to point out the anatomy to the undergraduate. This is your pancreas that you see in front of it. And that is the stomach. Where you see some airflow level here. That is the stomach. So, I'll ask Gaurav to elaborate on the treatment.
Yeah, in grade 3 injuries, the laceration is more than 1 centimeter. It is going into the cortex, but it is not going into the pelvic LCL system. So there will be no urinary extravasation. There will be laceration. There can be perinephric hematoma, but urinary extravasation is not there. So in this case also, patient hemodynamically stable, you'll get a CT, you'll find a grade 3 injury. Continue your conservative management. You need to admit all of these patients with a serial monitoring of the hemoglobin levels and also the vital charting. Also, you'll see some amount of hematuria you will always encounter in this patient, but that is not a thing to worry of. You will not see the hematuria and go for the surgery. Mainly the most important thing which we'll see is that is the hemodynamic status of the patient. If patient is stable, grade 3, conservative management.
Let us look at one more patient now. Now again in this patient you can see that is the lower part of the liver that is visible. You can see a bit of the gallbladder here. The left kidney looks intact, and you can see how the dye is taken up by the kidney. These are all contrast enhanced CTs. You can see how the dye has been taken up, and in the next patient I will show you some other finding which will help us utilize this platform. And you can see a laceration in the cortex. It's more than 1 centimeter in size. But the thing now is you can see medially as well as laterally, you can see the perinephric urinoma. And why we are saying urinoma is because the density is 0 to 20 Hounsfield, although I can't show you how we are measuring it, but on a real CT scanner we are able to do the Hounsfield measurement, which tells us that we are looking at a urinoma. That tells us that this laceration is extending till the pelvic lysis system.
Yeah.
So that will be a grade 4 injury.
Yeah, that will be grade 4 injury. And previously these injuries were considered for the surgical intervention. But nowadays, because of the, you can say, the nice radiological interventions, if there is urinoma, patient is hemodynamically stable, the first thing we'll do is we'll do a percutaneous aspiration. Under the ultrasound guidance or under the CT guidance, we can put a catheter and we can drain it. Even after the percutaneous drainage, if it is persistent, then with the help of the endoscopic procedures, we can put a stent. We can put a DJ stent so that the urine will keep on coming into the bladder and the urinoma will gradually subside. So these injuries, again, most of these injuries are managed conservatively these days because of the, like, if in cases, suppose there is in grade 4 injury, there is one more thing, that if there is a vascular injury but with contained hematoma, there will be hematoma at the medial aspect, it will not be like much. So in those cases, if there is in the delayed phase, if there is contrast extravasation, we can do angioembolization also, because patient is stable, he is not going to, you know, the hemodynamic status is maintained, but there is small amount of hemorrhage, that is active bleeding, which is still there. So in those cases we can go for selective angioembolization. So in grade 4, mostly conservative management, we might need to do few interventions in the form of percutaneous drainage or stenting or angioembolization.
So I personally believe that, you know, with the rise of the intervention radiology,
yes, service, yes,
and more and more intervention procedures available,
yes,
to us, maybe that we have taken a little bit of the surgery work.
Yeah, these days the surgeries, it is going more towards the conservative. You don't operate until unless you have to operate. So this is,
so that is
like
how you will see that, you know, I have seen, and I'm sure many of the youngsters listening to us would appreciate that nowadays a lot of people who are getting into radiology, they are getting into radiology with a vision to get into intervention.
Yes.
Because that is where the future lies today. So let me show you the next injury now. In the next patient, you can again identify this is the liver, gallbladder, that is your pancreas, portal vein, aorta, left kidney, and look at the right kidney. This is a totally shattered right kidney. So when you see either a shattered kidney or look at this, that is why I was showing you the contrast enhancement. This is the right kidney showing the normal contrast enhancement that we have been seeing so far. Look at the left kidney. So do you see some asymmetry? Do you see that? Do you agree that the left kidney is non-enhancing? Why? Why? And we see there is some problem here. You know, this part of the left renal artery looks abnormal. Maybe we are looking at a hilar injury. And that is why the kidney is non-enhancing.
Yes,
because that is, these are shattered kidney or a hilar injury in the kidney, we think of grade 5.
Yes, so these are grade 5 injuries, a completely shattered kidney or renal pedicle avulsion. So in these cases, there will be no contrast extravasation. Although the patient is still stable in this case, the patient is stable, that's why we did a CT scan. But most of these injuries are managed by the surgical intervention. Because in these cases, these patients can also be managed conservatively, depending more on the hemodynamic status is the most important thing rather than the CT finding. That is the most important thing. So in these cases, in few patients, we might continue the conservative management, but sooner or later, because of the risk of delayed hemorrhage, and also in these cases, sometimes the patient can get hypertension in the later on period. So nephrectomy is advisable, especially in case of shattered kidney, nephrectomy is advisable. So in these cases, we will go for nephrectomy. Although if you ask me what is the only absolute indication, that is hemodynamic instability, and the patient, if there is a threat to the life, then that is the only case where you can say you will have to go and do the surgery. So if I say surgery does not mean only nephrectomy. We most of the times these days we are going for the nephron sparing surgery, that is either we'll go for the renoraphy, that is you can say repair of the lacerations in case the patient is hemodynamically unstable, you have opened up the patient, then when you localize the injury. There are certain cases when the injury is not that extensive, but that is actively bleeding. So in that case, first we control the bleeding and then we can repair it. If a part of the kidney is not viable, then in those cases we can go for partial nephrectomy. So total nephrectomy only on those cases when the patient is bleeding massively and there is a threat to the life. So in those cases, to save the life of the patient, we need to remove one kidney.
Sir, very beautifully explained.
Yes,
you actually summarized everything, and I hope, you know, with the kind of radiological and the clinical correlation, you can actually visualize what we are talking about. So I hope you see that CCT today is the investigation of choice as far as the radiology,
yes,
goes, and radiology helps us to grade the injury,
yes,
which,
sir,
I have shown you how we actually say grade 1, grade 2, grade 3,
yes,
grade 4, 5 injury. And radiology also helps us to, you know, maybe to, you know, tell us, you know, especially when we are looking at the function of the contralateral kidney, that is in IVP, and that IVP is not done by the radiology department. That IVP that you hear about, single shot IVP, is done by the surgeons in the OT.
Yeah.
So usually, you know, for us today, I want to, you know, specify it here. Today, IVP is no longer the standard of care for urinary tract imaging. So please don't get confused when you look at old MCQs, old books, and you keep on getting it. Today, CT is the standard of care for urinary tract imaging.
Also, the other advantage of CT is you will get to know the status of the other organs also. Because the patient is having injury, patient might be having associated splenic laceration, liver injury, small bowel injury. So if you get a CT, you will get an image as a whole. You will see a whole of the abdominal tract, so that you should be prepared while doing, while going for the surgery. You should be have something in your mind that if you are opening up the patient, these are the things you, which you are going to encounter.
And that is why, you know, CT has taken over the imaging in trauma, in blood abdominal trauma as well. But the only thing that is required for sending a patient to radiology is the patient should,
he be, should be stable enough.
Yeah. You do not entertain unstable patients in radiology. That is the surgeon's domain.
Yeah. So
they have to take care of the unstable patients. Yes, so yes. With that, you know, I'll ask, you know, Gaurav again to give us a
You can see this is the diagrammatic representation in which you can see that the grade 1 injury, there is only subcapsular hematoma. In grade 2,
you can see the contour abnormality that we were seeing on CT scan.
In grade 2, you can make out that there is a small laceration less than 1 cm, but that can cause perinephric hematoma.
And we saw the same thing, less than 1 cm, yeah. We saw that on
a CT. Grade 3, it is more than 1 cm, going into the, you can say deep into the cortex, it might go into the medulla also, but the urinary extravasation will not be seen. There will be only the perinephric hematoma, no extravasation. And in grade 4, as you can see, there will be urinary extravasation. This point is that there will be thrombus in the vessel. That is the medial hematoma, and that is a contained hematoma. So that is grade 4. Grade 5, that is shattered, and here you can see the total vascular pedicle avulsion. So these are the, like, the schematic representation of the grading. And this is the American Association of Surgeons for Trauma and Grading. You know these, I mean at least these three stagings for splenic trauma, liver trauma and the renal trauma, these are important stagings. Although AST has given staging for each and every organ, but these three are the most commonly, we can say, the abdominal organs which are injured. So this is the summary of what we have seen, that is just in the form of a tabular form. That is the summary. You have seen that there is a subcapsular hematoma, hair laceration less than 1 cm, more than 1 cm, but no extravasation. Here there will be extravasation, and the vascular, you can see there is a contained hemorrhage and completely shattered, and total avulsion will be grade 5 renal trauma.
You actually explained it all very beautifully, and I think, you know, when I was a resident, it was even relevant for me as a resident also.
Yes,
you know, and I'm sure for surgery residents also, the entire picture is very important, even if you are a resident doctor there, and or if you are a PG aspirant. You need to know how we are imaging it, and what is the implication of each grade, and how the treatment changes with grade, and what is the main determinant of the surgery.
Yes,
and Gaurav has actually told it very beautifully that CT is not the main determinant of it is grading the injury.
Yeah,
it the is main determinant of surgery is the
hemodynamic status of the patient. Yeah.
So I hope you are able to take home the correct messages from the discussion. So we have selected kidney here because of the slight complex nature of the grading, and I think now you can understand it a little better. And I hope you enjoyed this episode of Unplugged. Do follow us on DAMS ED channel on YouTube for more such educational videos in future. And I would also, you know, recommend that if you have any comments or any doubts for me or Gaurav, please put them in the comment section.
Yeah,
or inbox us. We are very happy to, you know, answer. Gaurav has been teaching with us for a long time, and now I'm sure, you know, he can take you know, the doubts, and you know, any doubts from the radiology perspective I can take,
yes,
any
sir.
Surgery doubts he can take.
Definitely.
So
yeah.
Feel free to, you know, inbox us, or we will put them in the comment section. We are very happy to hear from you. And our goal is to simplify things and integrate things. That is our goal in this session. I hope you enjoy. We wish you all the best.
Thank you very much.